Anti-anxiety drugs are typically minor tranquilizers. They're typically central nervous system depressants. Now, there are some antidepressant medications that are thought to have anti-anxiety effects. There's probably some, you know, similar systems involved. There's a lot of comorbidity, meaning overlap between depression and anxiety. You're not guaranteed to be anxious if you're depressed, and you're not guaranteed to be depressed if you're anxious. But there is a substantial overlap between those two things. But when you're taking anxiolytic medication for anti-anxiety properties, typically you're talking about central nervous system depressants of varying types. We talked about those previously when we're going over medications in general and drugs in general. Antidepressant drugs regulate mood. We'll find there's one type that regulates mania, and that's lithium, but we're talking about really regulating depression here, trying to alleviate depression through manipulating monoamines via various pathways. I got the little asterisk there. They typically take 2 to 4 weeks to become effective. The asterisk is there if you saw on your test, and thank y'all for coming today, a question that said, if you knew somebody who said, I've been taking antidepressant medication for a week and a half and it's not doing any good, well, what should you tell them? Keep taking it. It's going to take a while to become effective. If it was just about a chemical imbalance, which it's not just about that, though lay people kind of need a simple explanation that they can understand. They go, that's chemical imbalance, right? That's genetic, right? Those are oversimplified explanations. If it was just an imbalance, then as soon as you start taking an SSRI, for example, a selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor, you get more serotonin. You would then get an alleviation of mood problems, right? You'd have an elevation of mood immediately because you get an immediate elevation of serotonin. But that's not what happens. With more serotonin being available in the synapse, the postsynaptic neurons have their regulated receptors downregulated. There become fewer of those specific receptor sites on the postsynaptic neurons. And that process takes 2 to 4 weeks. And that's what's associated with improved mood. Now, that's an interesting thing that most people don't know. But here's the thing, all antidepressant drugs don't work for everybody. Sometimes you need to go through a course at least 4 weeks before you realize it's not working for a person or not working optimally, in which case you might want to discontinue that and try another one. Most depressions will remit within 6 months on their own, about 80 to 85% of them. But who should suffer for 6 months hoping it'll go away when there is help available? And if we destigmatize it, people might actually seek the help and benefit from it because it's nothing wrong with us as people. It's just a human experience thing. Mood stabilizers, we're looking more now at the bipolar spectrum. So if antidepressants help with depression, what helps with mania? Well, there are a variety of mood stabilizers, but lithium is a classic. Lithium is an elemental salt. It's on the periodic table of elements. It can be toxic if not monitored carefully, so you got to be careful with it. Why does it work? We don't really know why it works. It just does work. It seems to abate mania, which can be a very dangerous state to be in. Full mania, as you hopefully remember, right, brings things with it like impulsive behavior, high-risk behavior without really considering long-term consequences as a possibility, right? Lack of sleep, potential psychosis. Has to last for at least 1 week unless hospitalization is required, which indicates some seriousness. So if there's a medication that stops that, that's good. And from my point of view, there's two major classes of disorders that might require long-term medication treatment, maybe even lifelong treatment, and that's bipolar 1 properly diagnosed or schizophrenia properly diagnosed. Those don't seem to go away for long periods before they rear again their ugly heads and cause problems for those who suffer from those disorders. Antipsychotic drugs, when we're looking at the schizophrenia that we talked about, where they've eliminated now the subtypes of schizophrenia, about 1 to 1.5% of the population suffers from this very debilitating disorder, where psychosis is the main symptom profile. You got old school major tranquilizers Basically, you knock people out. Not asleep, but you use so much tranquilizer that they couldn't become agitated. In some ways, it was like a chemical straitjacket. Now, we didn't go over the long history, I hope you read it in your notes, of mental health care treatment in America, but and the world over. But it isn't pretty. It isn't kind. To the people who've suffered, there's a reason there's a stigma attached to it. It goes way back to the supernatural model of mental health, where you must be afflicted by a demon or cursed by the devil to have the symptoms that you have, and maybe you deserve them. And so people were penalized for suffering, and they were treated poorly. In the old days, they cure you by burning you at a stake, perhaps. But then we got the rise of institutions where you thought you were going to get better care. But what you got was a lot of people bringing their family members, people they cared about, to get care. And pretty soon the institutions were overwhelmed. Not enough staff to handle the amount of people. And they became de facto penal institutions. Even though the people inside had not committed crimes, they were kept against their will frequently. Having committed no crime, they had no due process to get out. And they were frequently tied up. Rubber rooms were real things. Straight jackets are real things. Tying people to bed is a real thing because they're agitated for a lot of reasons. Part of which is the symptoms they're experiencing. Part of which may be the lack of receptivity to understanding what's going on with them by a few staff members who have to keep order amongst a bunch of people. A true tension, a hard thing to handle. And then they came up with Thorazine. Thorazine is a major tranquilizer. And it doesn't get rid of hallucinations and delusions, but it stops agitated behavior. And they used to have the thing they call Thorazine shuffle. So what you found was chemical restraint. Didn't necessarily have to put people in a straitjacket or do some crazy procedure like a lobotomy. A lobotomy, we didn't talk about, but taking basically a metal instrument and tearing up the frontal lobes of a person. Thousands were performed on people. Horrible and cruel because you damaged their brains because you had a hard time dealing with them. When they came up with Thorazine, it was like a miracle from an institution point of view. Thorazine shuffle, people walk around like this, shuffle their feet because they're chemically sedated. They're awake, but they're not agitated, which made them more manageable. And that was the advent of the whole pharmacological revolution in mental health care treatment. It helped other people, but it didn't really help the patient so much. All right, so couldn't we start to work on these pharmacological agents in a way that we actually helped the patient? And that became the primary goal. So we had a benevolent movement, and now we move from the old basic major tranquilizers to some new atypical antipsychotics. They also will decrease agitated behavior, but they also decrease not only tension, but hallucinations. So now the person is suffering less because they're hallucinating less. Delusions may improve, but social behaviors are also improved, meaning that it's easier for them being treated to get along with others and work with other people in a way that's beneficial to the patients themselves and produces better quality sleep. You'll sleep on tranquilizers, but it's not a good quality sleep. You'll sleep if you black out on alcohol, right, or pass out on alcohol, but it's not a quality sleep. So we found that we could use those. In addition to the lobotomy, in addition to the tying people up, they had back in the day this ECT, electroconvulsive shock therapy. Deliver bolts of electricity to your head. And you would be restrained so that your seizure would not cause you injury. Back in the day, anybody seen One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest? It's a pretty dramatic example of what that looked like prior to sedation that we have today. Now it's a humanely administered treatment. Before, it was probably used equally for treatment and punishment, as it was used as an example in that movie. For people who were hard to get along with, they might be taken and shocked, which induces a seizure. An electrical storm in the brain. If you remember, we talked about the corpus callosum, we talked about epilepsy, we talked about random firings of neurons, where if you separate the two hemispheres by severing the corpus callosum, it seems to stop epileptic seizures. Well, a seizure is random neuron activity, and the reason you see actual physical activity of a random nature is because that area of the brain is also firing signals randomly. right? Random motor impulses. So if you sedate somebody, you don't have the motor seizure, but you have the electrical seizure in the brain. And for some reason, again, unknown, it seems to alleviate depression. It's like hitting a reset button. On people who are profoundly depressed, they come out of it, and there's some side effects, the biggest of which is memory problems just prior to or just after the administration of shocks. But weigh that against the potential for suicidality and profound depression, and most people are willing to take the risk to get the benefit. And it's used today rarely. It used to be used liberally, as it was lobotomy used liberally, as was a lot of the early typical antipsychotics. But now it's only if you've failed getting treatment of a talk therapy nature and of a pharmacological nature, and usually a combination of the two, a person who is also a risk to themselves. They're suicidal, profoundly depressed. Essentially, at that point, you got nothing to lose except the patient. And this kind of a option becomes not only viable, but usually helpful. Again, not sure why, but it alleviates depression. It's not a permanent fix, though. Most times, people who are that profoundly depressed experience, you know, a remission for a while before it comes back, but you can administer it again. Psychosurgery is what we were talking about with lobotomy now, or the separation of hemispheres in the brain by severing the corpus callosum. Now, that's rarely used these days. Psychosurgery for the purposes of controlling mental illness is definitely not used. There are brain surgeries that we engage in for medical reasons, such as tumors, for example. Removal of a tumor, though, means excising brain tissue. And taking out brain tissue has potential for psychological outcomes, right? Because you're taking out part of a person's brain, whatever part that's associated with whatever behaviors, whether they're internal reflections, self-image, memory, or external behaviors. You know, we talked about back in the early biology chapter things like aphasias, Broca's aphasia, Wernicke's aphasia. Areas of your brain are associated with different behaviors, different experiences. To take out sections of that has implications for the patient's recovery. And they may lose aspects of what we think of as themselves or what they experience as themselves, depending on what happens. Yes, ma'am.
So is this the same thing as lobotomy?
No, lobotomy is one of the many types of psychosurgery. Lobotomy was a very common psychosurgery in the 20s and the 30s, and probably up until the 40s. And so psychosurgery just basically means brain surgery. And to do it for the purposes of treating mental illness would be psychosurgery. And I leave it there for historical purposes because we did used to use those fairly commonly before they were deemed inhumane and unethical and replaced by chemical agents, right, to keep people calm and easier to maintain. But even now, when we do surgeries on a brain, either for traumatic brain injury or whatever the case may be, there are psychological implications. We see that also with brain injury in terms of you see people who have head traumas coming back from combat, for example. People who never took shrapnel, right? But the concussion of an explosion throws them forward. They stop abruptly and the brain does not, right? It goes up against the side of the skull and jerks back. Having multiple concussions has implications for the way people experience their world and the way that other people experience them. Theoretically, that's brain injury, not something we have surgery for, but theoretically, we might come back to a point where we can very precisely and ethically treat problems with the brain through surgery.